The meeting will come to order. Good afternoon. I would like to remind everyone participating through Zoom to mute your microphones when not speaking to help minimize any background noise. If this is your first online meeting or first time using Zoom, please take a moment to locate your mute button. As an additional reminder, in accordance with the Freedom of Information Act, board member participation and discussion at this session is limited to members of the Finance and Land Use Committee. Board members that are not members of this committee are encouraged to mute their microphones and turn off their cameras until this session adjourns. In addition, please be aware that because this is an electronic meeting, all voting must be taken via roll call vote. The Finance and Land Use Committee is accepting public comment at this session. Registration for making oral comments was open until noon yesterday through the form on the Board of Visitors website. No registrations for oral comment were received, but written comments will be accepted through the same form until the full board meeting adjourns later this afternoon. To submit a written comment, please complete the electronic form on the Board of Visitors website under the Meetings and Materials tab at bov.gmu.edu. Our first item on the agenda is the approval of the minutes for October 1st, 2020. Are there any corrections to the minutes from the October 1st, 2020 Finance and Land Use Committee meeting? If there are no corrections, may I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
The clerk will call the roll.
Vice Rector Blackman?
Aye.
Visitor Itoregi is absent. Visitor Moss?
Yes.
Visitor Reagan?
Yes.
Visitor Rice?
Yes.
And Visitor Roth is absent. Thank you.
So the motion passes. We have three action items that require votes. To ensure timeliness and assuming there is no objection from other members of the committee, I will ask for a motion to approve them in block at the conclusion of the presentation. After that, the committee will be going into closed session. I will now turn the meeting over to Carol Kissel.
Thank you, Visitor Reagan, and members of the Finance and Land Use Committee. We have several presentations under the financial matters section. Deb Dickinson is going to present the FY 20 year-end financial performance, as well as the current year quarter one forecast. I'll follow that with some debt restructuring that we're going to be talking about. And then Renee Stewart O'Neill will be doing a presentation on our financial planning and also FY 22. So hand it over to Deb. Deb Dickinson, by the way, is our Vice President of Finance. Some of you may have not met her as yet. And she's also a member of the Executive Council. So, Deb?
Good afternoon, everyone. I will briefly review the fiscal year 2020 unaudited financial statements. We had the audit kickoff today with the Committee on Audit, Risk, and Compliance. The Commonwealth Auditor of Public Accounts is our auditor, and the APA, we have an excellent relationship with them. The audit is led on the financial side by the controller and associate controller teams. We have the field work will commence in January through March. Much of that will be remote, and that's actually consistent with prior years. We also have other ongoing audit procedures, including the NCAA agreed upon procedures, and that report should be issued around the January timeframe. And we have single audits of major programs. And for this year, those programs are the research and development, and it's also the CARES relief funding. Next slide, please. On this slide, we have the financial 21 unaudited compared with the FY19 audited results. The This is on the accrual basis of accounting, and our net margin for fiscal 20 is at $101 million. This is down slightly from the prior year, and you'll hear this theme throughout the presentation as a result of the COVID impact on our financial results in the latter quarter of fiscal 20 and into fiscal year 21. You'll see variances in our revenue and expense lines. Of the $101 million increase in net position, the majority of that is related to our net investments in capital assets. And that includes our Horizon Hall funding and also our utility infrastructure funding. Other variances we've had over the last year are for FY20, we had a $15 million increase in state appropriations. And this included tuition moderation and additional student aid. We also have other non-operating revenues from the CARES Act, and that's $13 million. On the operating expense side, we had a slight increase in our expenditures, and the majority of that increase was budgeted this year. There are some incremental COVID expenses, as well as there are reductions in our expenses due to our change and transition to remote telework. The chart on the right side, next slide. You're missing the slide. No, back one. Yes, sorry, that slide. The chart on the right includes a functional depiction of our revenues and expenses and is included annually in our financial statements. Now, next slide, please. On this slide, I've actually gone over the majority of the results. We have two additional items to highlight. Our net cash flows, we have a $38 million increase, and that's down slightly from prior year. Again, this is the COVID impact on our operations. Annually, we provide an update on our accounts receivable, and we had a low write-off comparatively. We have less than a half a percent of our write-off of our accounts receivable is written off each year. And in this year, we have focused on providing our students additional opportunities for payment plans. We've deferred certain of our collections, and we have worked closely with the provost office and other teams to provide any possible relief to our students in financial payment plans and late fees. So we've really made an effort. Next slide, please. All right, on the following slide, I will go over the first quarter forecast for FY21. Next slide, please. In our forecast this year, we are largely consistent with our budget. There are slight reclassifications in the budget that I'd like to highlight. It's simply reclassification between compensation and direct expenditures, and that was a result of our budget reduction targets. In our forecast, the changes you'll see are primarily from the state appropriations that reflects an additional $10 million from the special session of the General Assembly. We also have an additional $7.5 million in grants and contracts, and that is the coronavirus relief funding. That funding is only for the period through December 31st, 2020. We're still seeing the theme in our revenue and expenses on auxiliary side, the COVID impact. And we had slightly lower than expected volume on campus, and that resulted in revenues just below budget, and there was a corresponding offset in our expenses. The net impact of these adjustments is that we had, in the FY21 budget, we had presented a $38 million deficit, and we've reduced that deficit, and it's closer to $20 million now. And that's a result of our cost cutting and expense management efforts. I'm going to open it up now to see if you have any questions. I can't tell if there's any questions.
No other questions. We can move on to the debt restructuring if you like. Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Deb. If you can go to the slides on debt restructuring. As many of the members may recall, a few months ago, Governor Northam came to Mason to announce and propose a debt restructuring for the state of Virginia. And actually, the debt restructuring would include higher education institutions, and it would actually serve to defer their debt payments in fiscal years FY22 and 23. You know, in recognition of the financial pressure that many of the institutions are having, including Mason, and the restructuring could actually alleviate a lot of the liquidity issues that could be existent going forward. So if you go to the next slide. So as just a backdrop, actually, this shows you the amount of debt that we have on our balance sheet. It's about $488 million of direct debt for GMU outstanding debt. And then we have another $88 million of debt that's associated with, or $89 million is debt associated with capital leases through the foundation. So in total, actually, the debt is $581 million with removing the capital lease obligations. The debt chart underneath in the red box shows the debt that the state is looking to restructure, and that's the $245 million. Next chart. So that $245 million is typically debt that we have used, it's pooled debt with the state of Virginia that has been used to fund many of the capital projects that we have on our campus. So as I mentioned, those are the Commonwealth goals in restructuring the debt to relieve debt service payments. When we looked at analyzing the debt restructuring, we realized that, as you can see here, that the current weighted average cost of the debt would remain the same at 2.15%, given the low interest rates currently in the market. But the maturity of the debt for that $245 million would actually extend to 8.6 years versus 7.2. So when we analyze the debt, typically when you analyze debt at that long years, you're actually discounting the cash flows, and then you're looking at your net present value savings or dis-savings anytime you look at restructuring debt. In this particular example, when we discounted the cash flow savings, it would actually cost us about $700,000 just to restructure 1 year of debt. And then if we went all in for the 2 years, actually on a net present value basis, it would cost $1.8 million. Now, just to, and I don't have this on the chart, but I'll mention it. So the debt principal and interest payments that we are going to be making for those 2 years that we would defer is actually totals $40 million. So when we do the analysis, that $40 million would be deferred, and it would be actually moved to the middle and the back end of the debt. And because of doing that, actually the cost of that debt is really about an additional $10 million. But when you discount that $10 million to present dollar values, that's how you get the net present value of $1.8 million. And that would be the cost of the restructuring of the debt. So if you go to the next slide. So we have to, we have considerations. Do we do it? Do we not do it? Obviously, on the left-hand side, why would we restructure? It obviously provides us with great potential for liquidity if we need it. Currently, we don't. We have the amount. We have liquidity enough to actually make those debt payments for FY21. But this would actually give us some cushion and a backstop in case things potentially change for the spring semester or summer. We did examine the fact that it has no material impact to our credit profile or our issuer rating, which is currently at a AA. And I'll show you the financial metrics on that in the next slide. And then you could read the rest. Basically, the restructuring of the debt is a benefit because we're actually restructuring the debt on the Commonwealth AAA rating. And currently, that's allows us to keep the weighted average cost of debt at the 2.15%. So why we would not do it, we wouldn't do it if we felt like we did not need the liquidity. Mason could potentially restructure debt once we come to tier three, but we're not at tier three right now, so we can't issue the debt ourselves until the legislature passes that, which would be next June. And basically, those are some of the considerations there. The strategy on restructuring the debt is really a good one in terms of allowing us to have more liquidity, which gives us more flexibility, allows us to have those build up the reserves that we actually used this year for to close some of our budget gap. And it would allow us potentially for making some strategic investments now versus later. So those are all good reasons strategically why to do the restructuring. If you go to the next slide. Well, I'm not going to. So I'll go to the next slide. So those two slides, the next one. There you go. So those two slides that I just skipped over really are just the amortization tables of the debt. There's a lot of numbers, so you can go through that. But this slide is the one I wanted to talk about. On the top left is really the Moody's scorecard. And as we restructure debt and we look at refinancing or add more debt, we're always looking at whether or not we're in the framework of our Moody's scorecard, right? So we want to keep our AA credit rating. And this shows you what it means to be a AA, AAA, and an A1. And it shows you the percentages of weighting that the Moody's actually applies to your financial metrics. So they look at the market profile, they look at your liquidity, days cash on hand, and things like that. On the bottom slide, really that's just the debt that we have outstanding currently. But on the right-hand slide, this is really a ratio that we look at, which is called debt service coverage. So it's how much cash you have to make your debt payments. And we did four scenarios on this, and the colored lines show the scenarios. So if we took the existing debt service obligation, that was our base case. And then we looked at restructuring the bonds, which is scenario one, and what that would do in terms of the debt service coverage ratio. And then we looked at two, three, and four in anticipation that we would have debt capacity going forward for Arlington, for the construction of investments that we want to make. We wanted to make sure that it wouldn't impact that debt capacity going forward. And what this chart tells you that the debt capacity service coverage is not as impacted as much as the fact that our operating margins, which Deb just spoke about, that's really the impact of an influence on our debt service coverage ratio. So if we can recover on our operating margins for next year as we get through the pandemic, that will actually help that line that you see there. So the next slide. So we are asking the committee to allow management to enter into the restructuring and give us the ability to enter into that restructuring. We won't have to make the final decision until January. So at January, if things look a little bit different, we might make another decision, but we wanted to have the approval now in order for us to give us that flexibility. So I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Carolyn. Do you know our sister institutions in Virginia, are most of them taking advantage of this program? Do you know, or?
A lot of them are taking advantage of it. I don't have a list before me, Visitor Reagan, but they are, and mainly for the flexibility it gives them with liquidity. So some of them, the ones that are not taking it for the very reason that I showed you, where right, it doesn't meet their financial metrics. So.
Well, I don't have any. Are there any other questions? We can move on to the next item.
Great. Okay. So this next item, Renee Stewart O'Neill is going to talk about, but I wanted to give a little bit of a preamble. The presentation is going to focus on the update to our financial planning framework that was actually introduced not this past July at the planning session, but the one prior to that. And it's a major goal of not only the senior vice president, but of course the president as well. As many of you may recall, the transformation for financial planning began by constructing and communicating financial performance and information in a very different manner than the Finance Committee has seen before, hopefully more clear and more simple. Over the last year, we formed the financial presentations to the committee to represent providing a lot more details, risk assessments, forecasting, and we've collaborated with the schools, units, faculty, and campus to transform the budget and the planning process. Higher education, even prior to COVID, had been experiencing challenges on multiple fronts. So, and with COVID, it's become even a little bit more challenging. So the financial framework that we've introduced comes at just the right time as we allow ourselves to re-examine our investments, question what we do, and leverage opportunities in the future. And with an understanding of these financial challenges, we ask ourselves all these questions that I ask myself all the time, right? What levels of operating and financial performance are required to support the institution and their programs? How do we know the strategic initiatives are working? What should we plan to pursue in the future years? And are they affordable and will they work? What growth and cost reduction initiatives are we putting in place to ensure the long-term sustainability of the institution at Mason? And how are these reflected in our financial plans and forecasts? So all of these, and finally, you know, how does this all affect our debt rating, our ability to raise capital, and our ability to be transparent and collaborative with our state partners who are a big contributor of our capital program? So we attempt to answer those questions. At Mason, we have a decentralized organization, and so oftentimes the financial discussions or decisions may become barriers to that. Consequently, on the other side, you don't want to have all these decisions made at a central level. So the opportunity is actually to have more dialogue with respect to those investment decisions. So what you'll hear Renee talk about is the core planning function, the annual budgeting, how we've done this year in terms of improvements, action items that we have going forward. And then she'll spend a little bit of time talking about the fiscal year 22 plan. I know we're already planning for next year and thinking about, you know, some of the aspects of what we're thinking about for next year for the fall semester. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Renee.
Thank you, Carol. Good afternoon. I would like to turn to the financial planning framework slide, which is about three slides in. Go to slide 19, please. Yes, okay. I want to move right here because this slide is a visual depiction of the planning construct that Carol just articulated. The major areas of the planning continuum are represented here, and our overarching objective is to have multi-year financial planning that's grounded by institutional mission and priorities and supported by a capital structure with targets that drive the operating budget, capital budget, and capital asset allocations. This will lead to increased institutional discipline and strategic decision-making with accountability. Next slide, please. The next three slides that you're going to see are institutional budget and planning roadmap with a summary of our achievements to date, initiatives in process, and future milestones. The four categories you see here, operational budgeting, capital budgeting, multi-year financial planning, and integrated strategic financial planning, represent the stages of budget maturity at a large complex institution such as Mason. I want to highlight a few of the achievements that we've made to date. Next slide, please. In terms of operational budgeting, we've done organizational restructuring. We have new budget office leadership, role expansion and differentiation, and a more strategic mission. There's inclusivity and accountability. The budget office is a strategic partner with senior leadership and units. We have more inclusive processes, and we have a service orientation. And we've also developed standardized financial reports for units. In terms of multi-year financial planning, we're now introducing a multi-year planning horizon to colleges and administrative units with the fiscal year 22 budget planning process. We've established budget implementation planning groups to recommend high impact budget process changes in key process areas such as workforce planning, research, budget cost allocation, and infrastructure. In the future, we anticipate we'll have a full integration of a strategic financial planning and capital budgeting. And budgeting and planning will be done on an enterprise-wide basis. In particular, we're working on the implementation of a central cost allocation model. Well, there'll also be alignment of the operating and capital budgets. And I want to note here that this is an important new initiative. We have never integrated capital investments with our operating plan. So this is a new and particularly important endeavor. The financial framework will be aligned with university needs and higher education best practices, and there'll be a more nimble and flexible model that will enable scenario planning, timing, and other financial instruments to inform our financial plan. Next two slides, please. Next slide. Okay. These next few slides will inform the substance of my presentation because this represents the planning and the modeling that we're working on doing now. Critical to the modeling is the need to be able to consider multiple scenarios and multivariate assumptions as we develop new operating and service models for decision making along the planning continuum. This slide includes major environmental and operational factors on the left, which, when combined with our major revenue and expense assumptions on the right, can be input into our scenario planning tool to enable us to assess the viability of different outcomes for Mason. Let me highlight a few key operating factors and budget drivers for you. Let's consider the availability of a vaccine with full inoculation by the fall. This will have a significant impact on many of the variables here. Faculty, staff, and student on-campus presence, our mode of instructional delivery with a safer campus environment that will enable a greater number of in-person instructional offerings and an increase in classroom capacity. It will also lead to improved auxiliary enterprise revenues with additional students in residence. Our campus master plan is another critical planning variable. This will guide our major capital investments in both short-term and a long-term basis. One of the most critical budget drivers is our assumptions about enrollment growth and mix. Consistent with our commitment to the Commonwealth to increase degree production, especially regarding tech talent, and to be a regional economic driver, we plan for increases in both in-state and out-of-state enrollment, and especially assuming a pickup of international enrollment. We project a continued increase in our online percentage of enrollments, growing Nova Advance enrollments, as well as that of non-traditional students as we provide educational upskilling opportunities for displaced workers. Another major assumption that will drive our financial plan is our assumptions about faculty and staff growth. As an R1 institution, we need to increase the number of tenured and tenure track faculty to meet our enhanced research profile and our enrollment growth. We also need to fill critical staff leadership vacancies. Next slide, please. Okay. This next slide represents a set of budget planning assumptions using three different scenarios for fiscal year 22 through fiscal year 25. The baseline which represents no change from fiscal year 21. Our conservative is if we have a more limited recovery with more limited growth. And the third scenario is what we're calling our target scenario, which is our preferred scenario where we'd reach full recovery with the growth assumptions rebounding. And I want to emphasize here that these planning assumptions are for a planning exercise only. These represent a series of possibilities. No decisions are being made here. I want to walk you through some key revenue assumptions. So on the enrollment side, the target scenario assumes that we're going to grow by about 1,200 headcount per year. This is consistent with our CHEV projections and President Washington's goals. We also have assumptions about tuition and fees on the undergraduate and graduate side and strategic use of financial aid. For fiscal year 22, we're assuming no increase in tuition, and then in the out years, increases of about almost 4%. But again, these are for planning purposes only. We have assumptions built in about state appropriations, both enrollment general fund and state aid, and these assumptions are based upon a historical trend analysis of the usual annual increases each year. On the expense side, it is critical for us to make assumptions about what it would take for us to achieve more competitive compensation. As our enrollment grows, we need to make assumptions about increases in the number of faculty to support that enrollment growth. And we also are making assumptions about what it would take for our auxiliary enterprises to recover over time. And one of the new assumptions we have in here is a commitment to fund our strategic initiatives. And we have a benchmark of funding it at about 5% of our E&G revenues every year. Next slide, please. This slide demonstrates the power and flexibility of the scenario planning tool we're using. It takes the budget assumptions for the three scenarios I just described and runs them through the model to show the financial performance that each one generates. And the key message of this slide is that if we reach our target scenario benchmarks, we will have more money to invest in our critical strategic priorities. Next slide, please. So what are the next steps? In the short term, we want to frame our key assumptions, present modeling on demand, risk, and evaluate potential financial performance impacts within the five-year model. We're going to integrate the state budget assumptions. And finally, in May, we will present to you an All Funds Fiscal Year 22 budget. In the midterm, which is the latter 6 months of calendar year 21, we'll be moving towards a capital planning integration into the budget process. We'll launch those new budget processes that I referred to earlier, and we'll develop and implement performance management metrics. On the longer term, which will be towards the end of fiscal year 22 and fiscal year 23, we hope to identify a budget and development and planning tool to support an integrated financial framework that will align with a redesigned chart of accounts. We also plan to implement a central cost allocation model, which will allow transparency both about our revenues, the cost of operations, and align the service cost with the services that we deliver. So I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to talk about the work that we're doing now, and I will entertain any questions that you have.
Thank you. That was very good. Any questions?
Paul, sorry, I had to get all my buttons unclicked. Not so much a question as a comment. I just want to thank Renee and the rest of the staff for the work, because if you think back to where we were in June and we didn't know how bad could be, and we were making all sorts of assumptions, and as you reported in Carol's comments earlier, we are in such a better position than I think we all thought we would be. So I really want to recognize that and appreciate the work that you all have done.
Much appreciated. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Rector Hazel. So the next, matter is back to you, Carol.
Okay, great. Thanks, Renee. Capital matters. So we have a couple of, if you go to the slides, two items that we'll need an action to approve. The first one is a telecom infrastructure phase one. This actually is an approved project already. It's 100% funded by the state. And the scope of the work is, which has already been approved by the board, is to upgrade many of our educational buildings on campus, not only from an interior perspective, but also the outside plant improvements with respect to network. And so the first phase is mostly infrastructure work, and you see the budget that's listed here. If you go to the next slide, so the reason why it's coming to the committee today is because we're required to have the schematic designs approved by the finance committee, by the board. And so you see here the schematic design. The project, it's going to provide a critical network backbone to the West Campus, enabling future development. It'll also provide us with critical redundancy for network, which we currently don't have now. So there'll be areas where we don't have that. So that fiber ring that's established will be very, actually create a lot of redundancy on campus. So it won't disrupt things when we have some breakdowns. The switch building itself, which this is kind of an eye chart, so I apologize, but you could probably see it on your slides. It's a little red box. That's where the switch building will be. It's being designed to fit into the architectural motif of that area, right? So it'll have a red brick with the gray banding and a single sloped roof. The location will be such that it will be located in a location that's not a prime location, but that's adjacent to the athletic fields. The next phase will be more building specific. That's the picture of the building. Thank you. So that's all. That's it. And that will be an action item that can be approved later on in the schematic design. I have another, if you go to the next slide, and then the next one. This is the approval that we require to demolish the, I'm going to say this right, Jimmy, is it the CAN building or is it the CON building?
You know, that's been debated for decades.
Okay.
So it just depends on what side of the bed you got up on.
All right. Well, we're going to do the CON building. And we're really excited about this. This is obviously in anticipation that we would start the expansion project for the Arlington IDIA HQ building. And so we're going to be starting the demolition in December. We've actually had good dialogues with our wonderful neighbors, FDIC, and we have an MOU with them and working hand in hand, because if you recall that site, it's very, very close to the FDIC headquarters. So this request is to allow us to start the demolition. Once we start it in December or November, we'll start the decommissioning, and it'll probably take us through June to complete.
So. Great.
And any questions on those two items?
Well, Carol, remember we talked on the phone last week. If you can give me notice, I want to be there when things start happening.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea. We can, I mean, not that it kind of could be a ribbon cutting of sorts, right? Of a wrecking ball. And I'm not sure that's how it'll be decommissioned, but I will definitely inform the committee and you as well, Jimmy.
Well, if you look at that black
and blue alum would love to be there. So,
yeah.
Okay.
So well, when I looked at that black and white picture, if you to the left of that, when that tract of land was bought, there was just a basic retail strip center anchored by a giant food store. And I think all in, that's a $5 million investment on that, all that property in Arlington. I think that's what the university, if I remember my numbers right, that was a $5 million investment. And look what we got now.
And look what we're going to get.
Yeah.
So if there's not any more questions, we'll move on to the last presentation that we have, which is on HR matters and also retirement policy. So Lester Arnold, which some of you may or may not have met, is here today, and he's our chief of HR, and he's going to take you through both of those presentations. Lester.
Good afternoon. My first item is to discuss succession planning. Per the Virginia Code, you know, we're required to take a look at succession planning and to report out on an annual basis. Due to COVID, the DHRM, the requirement was actually waived this year, but the spirit behind this discussion is to provide updates and key planning observations. You know, it's the responsibility of human resources to plan for changes in our workforce and to be poised, planful, and talent ready. We do this by tracking specific metrics such as retention, turnover rates, as well as retirement eligibility. We also identify essential employees in key roles and by employing strategies to take a look at potential succession. So, you know, there are a couple of risk factors. Next slide, please. A couple of risk factors that I'd like to talk about Number one is, of course, the aging workforce that we're facing and looking at potential retirements and the gap, with a number of folks leaving with the institutional knowledge, which the next generation must be prepared to fill. Competition is also a concern, you know, as it relates to our local DMV competitors. So it's a challenge as other employment options create unique challenges in attracting and actually retaining talent. You know, as we are aware, the pandemic has offered additional challenges as, we shift priorities requiring either reskilling or upskilling of our workforce. So in our process, you know, we've highlighted key personnel in critical positions that impact the mission, operations, and student experience with an understanding of any kind of negative impact if those positions remained unfilled. Next slide, please. So in taking a look at key personnel, we've actually identified 43 essential employees, which include vice presidents, deans, and other senior leadership positions. 35% of that population are not eligible for retirement. 74 are over the age of 55 years of age, and 26% could retire within the next 5 years. 28% are currently eligible to retire. And if you look at the entire GMU benefited employee population, 10% of those folks are actually eligible to retire within 5 years. Next slide, please. Other key observations, this first graph on the left, it's kind of a look at the Mason generational makeup compared to the nation. You know, a couple of items to note would be our significant millennial population, Mason's baby boomer population, which is slightly higher than the national makeup. So that would be actually about 26% of our population, which are factors to consider as we build a bench of ready talent in anticipation of high number of potential retirements. The pie chart on the right speaks to the Mason benefited employees, and about 71% are ineligible for retirement at this point. 14% are eligible now, and 5% are within the age of 55 to 57, and 10% are within 5 years of eligibility. Next slide, please. So our action plan to ensure that we're prepared include both short-term and long-term strategies, such as our continued focus on this enterprise-wide initiative in partnership with senior leadership. Also identifying and a dedicated resource to oversee this whole process around performance management and succession planning, and adapting and utilizing a succession planning tool that we have been taking a look at and kind of updating our technology to help facilitate this entire process. We'll continue to work. My team has done some work on compensation strategy in addition to market studies to ensure that we're paying equitably and competitively, and also the work that we're doing around professional development, training, and coaching helps build this this talent pipeline that I'm speaking to. So our ongoing actions include the continuation of talent discussions and really focusing on our recruitment and our development strategies to ensure that they're in alignment with the overall university's strategic goals. So that's it on the succession planning piece. I'll jump right into the retirement plan investment policy review, and then any questions, we can kind of go back. So the investment policy committee is required to report out on an annual basis. The investment policy statement applies to our defined contribution plan, referred to as the ORP. So this is offered to our administrative and professional faculty. There's also an associated cash match plan, in addition to a supplemental defined contribution plan for employees, referred to as our 403B. This does not cover the 457, the Virginia Retirement System VRS plan, which is defined and managed by the Commonwealth. This investment policy committee is chaired by me as the CHRO, and the role of the committee is actually take a look at our investment policies that guide the investment and the ability for our members to save for their retirement. The IPC works with our financial advisors, Cap Trust. Actually joining us today is Barry Schmidt. He's actually here online. He's the vice president and financial advisor, and he also serves as the advisor to the IPC. So he's made himself available today to respond to any kind of investment related questions. So he is here, and Barry, thank you for attending. Let's take a look at the ORP investment overview. Since 2019 BOV meeting, total assets have increased from $518.1 million to $576.6 million. And you look at the TIA ORP, assets increased from $359 to $394.2 million. The TIA cash match assets increased from $15 million to $17 million. Fidelity ORP assets increased from $134.3 million to $155.3 million. And the Fidelity cash match assets increased from $8.8 million to $10.1 million. So as a committee, and part of our review is also to take a look at active and hardship loans. And currently, there are about 31 active loans, which is a significant increase from last year, where the number was 11. Hardship loans increased significantly as well, from 8 to 16. And this is no surprise due to the financial hardship placed on families during this pandemic and current challenges. And the active hardship balance actually increased from 25K to where it stands right now of 207,000. Next slide, please. So a couple of items and accomplishments to mention. You know, as part of the changes in the TIA platform, several funds will be changed to lower cost share class. Also, one fund was replaced due to underperformance. And back in February, Barry and the Cap Trust team provided fiduciary training for all of the committee members. Some pending items, small balance payouts we're taking a look at. Regulations actually allow plans to pay out small balances for terminated participants. There's a cost to maintain the participants' account. Removing these small balances make our plans more efficient and more cost effective. And there's a fee renegotiation with both TIA and Fidelity, and Mason, generally works with our investment consultants and periodically look at renegotiating fees associated with the administration of our plan. And also, as market improves, as efficiencies are gained in technology, the ability to lower cost participants pay for services has been proven. And also, we anticipate being able to reduce rates in the coming year, along with looking at ways to be more transparent as it relates to those fees. And that is pretty much my presentation. If there are any questions for me or Barry regarding succession planning or the investment piece.
Yeah, I have a question on that. Maybe this is a question for Carol. In last meeting, we were talking about moving into tier three status.
Yes.
How is that going to affect things like contribution to retire? As I understand, we will become university employees as opposed to state employees.
Well, yeah.
How is that going to affect health insurance, retirement contributions, and even things like Medicare supplement, et cetera.
Right. So the fact that we're moving towards a tier three, and hopefully we get that approval by June, doesn't automatically mean that we would move to be have a different portfolio of being a university employee with different, you know, kind of benefits and the like. That's going to take years to do that part of it. So if we decide to do that, right? So it just gives us the opportunity to do that. So the work that Lester and HR would do and my team would examine what it would take to be a university employee, how we would then structure maybe a possible new benefit plan that could align with the state, definitely align with Mason initiatives, and that would have to be examined. So it's it's not an automatic.
So one of the concerns expressed by some of my colleagues is that when you are in a health insurance pool with the state, which is a much larger pool, that the rates tend to be lower. But if it becomes a university pool, it's going to be probably higher. I mean, some of these, I know
right.
It is too early, but I just wanted to raise that issue.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. Specifically on the benefit, of course, you're going from a large pool to a small pool. That's problematic. But we can maintain being state employees even if we're at a tier three. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Great.
Maybe Shannon can take it up as a Senate issue. This is much larger. So this is from within our school. Some of the questions I got, but I didn't get any feedback from the Senate when I put that in the minutes. The faculty Senate agenda. Excuse me.
Okay. Any other questions or?
Take that to the Senate Budget and Resources Committee, who regularly interfaces with Carol's office. And so I appreciate that suggestion.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, if there are no other questions, as I mentioned earlier, we have three action items that require a vote. One, approval of the debt restructuring that Carol described. Two, approval of the schematic design for telecom network infrastructure phase one. And then number three, approval of schematic design and major scope change for the Arlington demolition. I move that the committee approve the three action items as detailed in the board book. Is there a second?
I second.
Any discussion? The clerk will call the roll.
Vice Rector Blackman?
Aye.
Visitor Iturregui is absent. Visitor Moss?
Yes.
Visitor Reagan?
Yes.
Visitor Rice?
Yes.
And Visitor Roth is absent. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. We will now go into closed session. I move the board go into closed session pursuant to Virginia Code Section 2.2-3711.A.29 to discuss a public contract relating to the Institute for Digital Innovation. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? The clerk will call the roll.
Vice Rector Blackman?
Aye.
Visitor Iturregui is absent. Visitor Moss?
Aye.
Visitor Reagan?
Aye.
Visitor Rice?
Aye.
And Visitor Roth is absent. Thank you.
Okay, so the motion passes. We'll now go into closed session. We're back now in open session. I move the committee go into open session and further move that by roll call vote, we certify that one, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements, and two, only such public business matters as were identified in the motion by which the closed meeting was convened were heard, discussed, or considered in the meeting by the board. Any member of the board who believes that there was a departure from the requirements as stated above shall so state prior to the vote, indicating the substance of the departure that in his or her judgment has taken place. The clerk will call the roll.
Vice Rector Blackman?
Yes.
Visitor Itoregi is absent. Visitor Moss?
Yes.
Visitor Reagan?
Yes.
Visitor Rice?
Yes.
And Visitor Roth is absent. Thank you.
Okay, is there any other business before the committee? There being no further business, I declare the meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.